Hi, I will be going to talk about the horizontal structural borne noise transfer in a large concrete slab this time. And the earlier talks on this relate on this material has been a BNOM talk I had, which is on the sources and maths, effect of maths and so on. And then I had a follow-up on vertical noise propagation in a slab supported building from weight drops in the cellar. And today I will look at the horizontal situation. I have a YouTube channel where I share these movies, and I will also share the talks, the slides on ResearchGate, on account I have there. The scope of this talk is to an investigation, is to look at source and energy characteristics, hard versus soft, high versus low, how much decibels, how many decibels per meter do you get in a concrete floor? And how does the room acoustics influence the results? I thought it didn't influence at one time because I record with very short time, the lowest we can have on the instrument, 25 milliseconds, but still the room turned out to play a role, as we will see. Max fast is 125 millisecond integration time, and the sound waves travels from 9 meter at 25 milliseconds up to 42 meters in 125 milliseconds. So you will have several reflections in a small room at least during that timeline. And there's also different radiation situation. From concrete, you will have almost all the vibration energy goes over to sound, while for light walls, the situation is more complicated. And you can have large amplitudes, vibration amplitudes, and less of that energy goes over to sound or noise, at least as an approximation. Okay, this is the test room and the test situation. And the hard sources are a 40 kilo manual, and then some grip plates with the rubber on them, 5 kilo, 10 kilo, and 15 kilos. And then we have a set of bumper plates, and I tested 10 and 20 kilos, and I put some of these on the Olympic bar we have, and dropped it from hip height. And the manual is dropped from the bench, and the stone there is my height indicator for the plates, 13 centimeters. And you see the sender room microphone there on a stand on silomere supports there, a little bit of a vibration insulation. Yeah. And I used four of our 140 Norsonic measurement units on stands. And we have one in the source room, as we said, as I said instead. And we have a dead receiver room at about 6 meters. I will show you on a separate slide later. And we have a meeting room at about 60 meters from the source. And we have a reception area behind the closed door at 30 meters. And I recorded sound and spectra in 1/3 octave bands every 25 milliseconds. And these are the sources I use, the grip plates with some data on the drop height and the resulting energy, and a theoretical assessment of how strong the noise will be from these at a given, this given drop energy. And I know the answer, so it's easy to put us put this out, but we have a pretty good grasp on the source characteristics regarding force, even though it's very difficult to deal with that. Measuring force is difficult. We assume that the manual and the grip plates are equally hard when we do these assessments. This is the building we did the tests in, and it's the fourth floor up there. It's a very large building, really. It's in the order of 50 meters in that direction and another 50 meters in that direction. And it's column supported. You see the columns here, about 6 meters in the length direction between them. And then it's about, it's 5 meters between them in the this direction. There's staircase room with hard walls around them here, and light walls, light wall, light wall, and heavy wall, heavy wall, heavy wall. So there's a mixture of heavy and light walls. The pattern for those columns is a bit strange. There must be something carrying the building in that line as well, but I haven't found exactly how that is. We have the source room here, number one, and then the first receiver room, number two. It's a, what I call a, it's a listening room. It's made for playback of for listening, and it's almost like a control room, very dead in the high frequencies, mid and high frequencies. This room is a former kitchen, and it's more balanced in the reverberation time in the low frequencies here, 63. The rooms are more or less similar. This one with the brick walls or concrete walls on each side has more boomy sound. A bit less dead than the listening room. And this reception area is more or less like a normal office. The distance is 29 meters, and it's 15 meters to this room. And it's 6 meters over to this room. And I closed the doors when I did the tests, also here to reduce the any airborne contribution to the levels. I should have used this room as we would then get the line, but I know from earlier experiences that it rattles a bit in this room from shelves and so on, so I choose not to use that room this time. And here we have the reverberation time of the different rooms. The dead room, the listening room is this one. And then we have the one with brick walls with high reverberation in the low frequencies and quite dead. It's a meeting room with a video conference system. And then we have the reception area, which is pretty balanced, and the blue line is the former, or still our kitchen, pretty flat. This is the test sequence. Here I dropped the 40 kilo manual, and then 10, 15, and 5 kilo grip plates, And then I go over to bumper plates with more rubber on them. There are 20 centimeters of rubber. And you can see on the curves here that the impact is more lasts longer, and it's more low frequency dominant. This is a mishap. My brick there turned over and hit the bench. But the 1, 2, 3, 4 of these with 20 kilo bumpers, and then I had one test with the 80 kilo Olympic bar, and I used the three bounces in the analysis. And of course, all this was done in an evening when the building was more or less empty, when everything was in place. It only took about 2 minutes to do the test with recordings. It's very fast, but you need a lot of time afterwards to do the analysis. This is the zoom up of the manual drop, and you can't really see much more than that there's bouncing, and I think I stopped it with my foot. But there, if the time, the contact time is interesting regarding the force, and if you want that, you need to do fast video recordings or have transducers for that. And in, as a consultant, you can do these tests with a client, but it takes too much time. Yeah, just wanted to show you the details here, and it's of course influenced by the room acoustics. So if you want a cleaner signal, it's better with the accelerometer signals, for instance. This is the Olympic bar, and the sound file is clipping a bit here, but you see it clearly, it bounces at least three times, and the impact and the time between the impacts is a little bit longer than for the manual. And there is a bit of a rattle in this signal. Yeah, this is the spectra of the set in the sender room of the hard sources, and it's manual up there, and the grip plates, three grip plates here, and the grip plates look somewhat similar in spectrum. There's a little bit of ringing, which probably is from the plate itself, and we see that the frequency maximum is a bit higher up in frequency for the manual than it is for the grip plates. So it's probably harder, or it's a harder hit. It's also a lot more energy to it. Here are the soft sources for the same room. You see the bumper plates down here, pretty flat. The Olympic bar there is more energetic, so you get more sound, but there's also a bit of rattle there coming from the vibrating bar against the metal and the lock there. And I have the manual spectrum for reference here. This is in the listening room. The difference between, no, the manual is blue. The difference between the spectra is now somewhat less, I think. There is a little tendencies of either resonances in the floor or roof, or in the room. And we see that the background noise when you come to about 31, 3.15 kilohertz, there's no more signal. So for the weak sources here, this is not a very good source to use regarding the high frequencies, but the most happens here, of course. And here we have the bumper plates in the same room. We see the same tendencies of some resonances there. The Olympic bar drop, you can still hear some rattle through two doors, not so good doors. And in the center room, the level is very high. It's almost 100 dBA in a short sequence. It's more cut, and we see the manual is a different animal, harder animal, less flat. There will be many of these curves, so let's go through them. This is in the meeting room with brick walls, these are the hard sources, and there's traces of resonances here. There's signal up to 3.15 here also. This is a load room because you have those brick walls. So it's actually louder than the listening room, which is dead. So even though the distance is more than twice, so we can already hear say that the room acoustics matters. Here we have the bumper plates in the same brick wall room. We see clearly resonances, and now the airborne component of the rattling bar is gone. We mainly see almost a flat spectrum there, and the manual is more distinct and a stronger source. Clearly, even though the energy is four times as large for this, at least three times as large for this drop here. This is in the furthest distance. It's almost 30 meters away. Reception area, we see still traces of resonances. According to Craig, resonances like this is more likely to be originating from the receiver room than the sender room. But we do not know for sure. It's not a big deal really, but you can see traces of it. And here are the soft sources, and here the background noise is almost meeting the noise from the bumper plates up to from 630 hertz or something. The manual is a clear signal still, and the dropped Olympic bar is also above the background noise clearly. And we see something I think must be a resonance. It can also be, I know that the bar does vibrate, does have a mode at around 63 hertz, but we haven't gone into details with that. We don't see it up here, so, but it's traces of it here, for instance. So maybe it's a bar related thing, and then Craig might not be right about this one, at least. Now we see the same source in each different room. and this is increasing distance and the rooms for the Aleiko manual. And this is the same for the grip plate, and they are sort of related, those hard sources. So I look at them as more or less similar sources. We see in the meeting room there's a clear tendency for the resonances, and when I listen to the signals, you also get the impression that this is boominess from the concrete or the brick walls. But I haven't confirmed that yet. It's kind of an interesting thing. It doesn't influence the overall sound level. So, but this is also a ringing in the plate, the 15 kilos plate there. The rubber doesn't damp the metal so much, so you hear it immediately when you have the plate, but it doesn't influence the overall sound level, so it isn't important really. And here we have the soft sources for each room at increasing distance. What should we say about this? It's flatter, not really a good source. There's a bit more here. Here we see traces of, for this room, the brick room with brick walls, you see that now the resonance is dominating the overall sound level, and you can't look away from it. And this is also what we can expect will happen when we start to put mats, soft mats and thick mats under the sources. You will end up with a stronger influence from resonances in the low frequencies, which are the density of the resonances is much lower in the low frequencies than in the high frequencies. And but we are only measuring with one position. We would, if we were to test according to the standard, we would use three recording positions in each room, and one of them in a corner. And then you would average out a little bit of resonances, but they will still be there. And the ringiness of the resonance in the room or in the concrete, it will both influence the experience. And for transients, you will get reverberation, and you will hear it better the more reverberant the system is. So that can be dangerous. And here we have the Olympic bar with the rattle, and then less rattle, and so on. And here we see either a source thing, or in this case, I think it's a source thing, here at 63, and it's the bar, I think. And in this reception room, it dominates the response. But we have to look more into this and figure out. And here we have the reverberation time again, just to remind us that the reverberation time also does influence the recorded response. This is the insertion loss from the sender room to the different receiver rooms. So this is over to the listening room, and there is kind of a similar response there. There's a little bit difference here for the bumper plates, and I think the reason for that is that because the width of the bumper plate becomes so large that you get some kind of clapping noise from from it when it hits the floor, and that dominates a little bit in the sender room, and then it disappears in the receiver room. So, and up here we have the Olympic bar drop, which is high because it's a lot of airborne noise. But we see from 200 hertz, it's equal to the others. This is at 16 meters in the brick wall room. The brick wall room is exaggerating this region. So to make it a normalized room, sort of, you would have to increase the response here or the difference here. And I show the curves for the corrections there using the radiation area of the sender room and absorption area in the sender room as a reference, and then it's the radiation area in the reception room over the or under the absorption area in the reception room. And then you get curves like this with the reverberation time, it's one for each octave band, and the one with brick walls, you will have to correct the low frequencies by increasing it, and the listening room by reducing the response because it's so dead. Above 3.15, we only have noise here, except for the 40 kilo manual and sort of the Olympic bar, but it becomes unnaturally high here because the sender room response is so dominated by the radiated sound from the source itself. So it isn't a good source really for that case. And here we are at 30 meters, and here we see a little bit ringing from the 15 kilos grip plate. Otherwise the curves are more or less the same. It's interesting to note that the transition loss from receiver room to sender room is increasing with the frequency. Almost like a mat, it would probably increase steeper, but still, and we might return to this. Here we see the drop energies of the different sources and the recorded levels of the different sources. And the manual are those. And then we have the grip plates here, and this is the reception room there, and we have the listening room there, and we have the meeting room here, and the source room here. And this is quite powerful curves I show here. These can be used for prediction of expected sound levels for these kind of sources in different positions in the building, when we also know something about the transition from one place to the next. And you can do measurements and make curves like this, and then you can predict how much energy somebody can put into the floor or system before it's over requirements. So I didn't even invent these curves myself. I found articles from the 60s with graphs like this, but there are not many of these in any textbooks. You won't find anything about this in any textbook, I think. Textbook on acoustics, it's totally missing this transient bit of information. It's too difficult. Here we have the soft sources, and you get almost parallel lines. And I have this is the center room levels of the bumper plates, and I skipped the levels for the Olympic bar up there because it's just airborne noise. It would be steeper. But now the sequence between these curves is the same, those curves, but you see here that the meeting room, which is at 16 meters, lay above the data from the listening room, which is dead at 6 meters. When you do correction of the room response and radiation, these will change the position. But it's a good thing that there are some clear patterns in here. We are getting back to the spectrum from the Olympic drop. More details about the measurements. The blue data here is for the manual, and the orange there is and the blue here is the Olympic bar. So for those who want to watch this a little bit further, I can do it here. And again, I point to the resonances. And here I have done a calculation based on something I found in an article by Crispin and Ingelar and Gutierre. And it's an internoise proceedings article, and it turns out to build on Hopkins and Kremer-Heckel, and it's about bending vibration velocity loss in a plate. And you get, it's not magic, this. You can probably you're probably able to calculate, make this expression yourself. I have during a meeting. And in the near field, or there's a geometric loss you get, like from a point source, like if you drop something into water, it will dilute. And then there's a propagation loss, which is dependent on the loss in the plate and surroundings. And it's proportional to the loss factor and the distance traveled. And then it's the bending wave speed underneath there, which is a little bit varying with the frequency, because bending waves are dispersive. But for simplicity, you can think about this as 342 meters per second, like in air. And then you have the frequency there. So what I plotted here is the distance from the point source along the x-axis, and then the drop in energy along the y-axis. And the straight line there is the geometrical loss. And then I have added geometrical and propagation loss for 16 hertz there, and 100 hertz there, and 500 hertz there, and 2000 hertz there. And you get a relation or a situation which is quite similar to what you have in air, because in air, the high frequencies are damped faster than the low frequencies. So when you hear something at the distance in air, it will be more bassy. And the loss factors used here comes from literature measurements from 1980s by White and Lia Sjö. There's also data from CSTB, Craig, Fisher, and I've also used ISO 12354.1 for a large plate similar to the one I've measured. So I'm taking the average there. And then you get structural reverberation times in around 16 hertz at 0.9 seconds, and at 100 hertz it's 0.4, at 500 it's 0.1, at 2 kilohertz it's 0.05-ish. The plate is probably then more dead than in high frequencies than in the low frequencies, which is kind of what you experience when you heat concrete and you get the heatering. These numbers will, of course, or at least in Lia Sjö and White, they find that, and also I've seen that in Hopkins' book, that when you measure concrete on ground, you get much higher damping. But I'm not sure if that is true any longer, because the concrete is resting on thick XPS or EPS, and it's more like a floating floor. So I'm not sure that if those old data are usable any longer, but that we can come back to that. Here I've plotted the results. This is the listening room, and it's the soft sources there and the hard sources here. Then it comes to the hard room, and the loss is apparently lower, and then to the receiver room, reception room, where it is more like expected values. I've done some calculations to correct for the room response and radiation, and it becomes a bit better, but it's not a fantastic similarity here, but it's not all that bad given the special conditions the measurements were done in. We get this is a simple regression there on only five or four data points, which is a little bit too small, but you can calculate that over to about 16 log distance, or 1.6 decibel per meter at 10 meters. But these numbers will change. If you have a very lossy floor, it will be much more, and even much more further, because the response, the effect of the damping starts earlier. So I think that is one of the factors that influences the response of cross-laminated timber, for instance, at least when it's wet and you have gravel on it. So, that was a sidekick. Well, here I show an attempt to utilize what I said instead, that the air has higher losses at high frequencies. And it's also dependent on the humidity content. So you can twist and tweak that a little bit. And this is from using Odeon, it's a room acoustics calculation program. And what I've done here is to make a concrete slab, sort of. It's a room with the height of the thickness of the concrete. I've made the walls absorptive, kind of simulating energy transfer to other places. And you can also control to some extent the distance loss in concrete by using the absorption properties of the concrete. You can set whatever you want here. And this is quite promising in the plane. And here is a little bit more refined model with the columns in there. I've done some incorrectness here, but I at least it gives a good idea. Maybe I wanted to see what happens if you cut concrete and you have a node or what do you call it? You get losses when you have a crossing. So it's experiments, but the data here for the floor is not all that bad. However, here is the most refined model I made. And all this is done in my spare time, so I can't sit full time doing this. Here is the results from that model, and we have the floor here, and we have the roof here, and the scale is here. Green is 70 decibel-ish, blue is 50, 60, and the red is 80, 70, 90 decibel up to 100. What I see is that between the floors, we all get as much as 29 decibel difference, which is more than what we expect. And I wonder what the reason is. Maybe because we haven't included staircases and slabs between the floors. I also do not know what the correct number is there. So I would like to do a measurement campaign again with some accelerometers placed around. Also in the roof. Here is what happens in the plane there. The three models we show, the most refined one is the sun's here, sort of. And this is the measured levels, and this is the calculated levels. And it's not all that bad. It's quite good, actually. But we have to remember that in ray tracing, we do not have resonances, and in statistical analysis, energy analysis, we do not have resonances either. So we have to figure out what is the best way to do. So in spite of some rattle and resonances, there was some rattle. I haven't said anything about that regarding also the receiver rooms. There was rattle in the meeting room concrete or masonry walls a little bit, but the transfer seems mainly linear, and soft sources give flatter spectra than the hard sources, and they are also more quiet. It's more like hard sources on a mat. The response can be predicted from drop energies, source knowledge, and distance losses. So it's quite promising, simple relations here that can be used for assessments. The room acoustics, the size of the room, and the radiation properties of the rooms does influence the result. I didn't know I did. So I learned this through this measurement campaign. Regular diffuse field theory seems to apply. And the geometrical loss dominate near the source, then the propagation loss matters more at larger distances, typically above some 10 meters. further work, I think it's important to measure vibrations because that is a problem, and get data for more rooms and also get data from the roof and look at the propagation in the vertical direction. And we should include mitigations like mats, and maybe a mock floating floor and see what happens. It gives some, the better fixings we have, the more complicated and difficult it becomes to do good measurements. And that's really, if you want to work on good stuff, you really need to be have good stuff to measure with, and know what you're doing. There is not much data on this, and one of the reasons is that it's difficult. I think it's interesting to also investigate radiation from light walls. Maybe the double wall resonance influences. Measure loss factors in concrete floors, also on ground. What is the real losses? I don't think all data are applied. You can use them any longer. We're not putting the concrete on gravel any longer. Maybe investigate further use of ray tracing in buildings and figure out how we can make them a better models. And I also work on scale modeling very slowly and test column buildings versus slab supported buildings. And that's all. Thank you for now.